Hello. So today I'm going over 9.7, which is probability. So I'm going to go over several different definitions and then do many different examples for you. So 9.7 covers finding probabilities of events, finding probabilities of mutually exclusive events, finding probabilities of independent events, and finding the probability of the complement of an event. So, I'm going to start with just the definition of sample space. So, the sample space is the set of all possible outcomes of an experiment or trial, just all the possible outcomes, just or what the results could be. So, as an example here, find the sample space for tossing a coin and a six-sided die. So, if we look at a coin just has two possibilities, heads and tails. And a single die has six sides that go from one to six. We've got two choices for the coin, six choices for the die. That should give us 12 choices altogether. And so we write down all those possible combinations of one coin, one die. So I usually do this by making a table to help me remember all the possibilities. So let's say I'm going across. I have all the choices for rolling a single die, and then I have all the choices for the coin. It's heads and tails. And so now I've got this table, and this will help me organize it so that I remember and make sure I have all the possibilities. Because you can see there's going to be 12 because there's six times two. So I can have heads and a one. I could have heads and a two, heads and a three, and so forth. And you could have tails and a one, tails and a two, tails and a three, and so on. So all of those combinations, that is called the sample space. And we usually write the sample space as a set. So I would use set notation and then I would write all of my choices. If there's a pattern, you can just use dots to indicate the pattern. And that way it can save you from writing every single choice. So the sample spaces, those are all the things that you have, all the combinations of outcomes that you have to choose from or that could possibly happen. Now, the probability of an event. If an event has n equally likely outcomes, so like rolling a dice, six outcomes are equally likely, and its sample space has n equally likely outcomes, then the probability of event E is the probability of n for the event over n to the s. So, an example of this. It would be in the probability that you're rolling a two on a dice, and there's six outcomes, only one way to get a two. All probabilities have to happen between zero and one. So, because a probability can also be read as a percentage, zero means never happens, it's a 0%. One means 100%, it's going to happen, it will always happen, is another way to think about it. So your probability has to be between 0 and 1. So if you end up with a probability that's negative or bigger than 1, you have made a mistake because that is impossible. So let's take a look at an example. We have a coin that is tossed three times. What is the probability of getting two tails? So probability is very much related to counting. So we got three choices, and I have two choices for each. Two, either heads or tails, and then I can get heads or tails, and then heads or tails. So I did something similar to this in 9.6 when I was doing counting, where I would write down all the choices and then how many possibilities you have to get that. So two times two times two means we have eight total possibilities.
Thank you.
So now, if you think about this, you can also write this as 2 to the third power, because you get 2 choices and you're doing it 3 times. So it's not 2 factorial, because that makes the assumption that once you make a choice, then your next choice is limited. Here, the toss of one coin is unrelated to the toss of the next. And so the same number of choices occurs for each toss. And so that's why it's 2 to the third. So that's the total number of possibilities. And we want to get exactly 2 tails. And so you think, okay, what are the probability of exactly 2 tails? How many choices are there for that to happen? So you need to look at the sample space by writing all of your choices. So we should have, let's see, we've got, you know, we have 8 possibilities. So we can have heads, 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 tails, heads, tails, heads, heads, tails, tails, and then tails, tails, tails. I'm just trying to change each head to a tail and trying to write down all the possibilities here. So that we've got 3, 4, 5 so far. We could have tails, tails, heads, tails, heads, tails, tails, heads, heads, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. We've got all of them there. So we got 8 possibilities, and now which ones have 2 tails? So we've got 2 tails there, 2 tails there, 2 tails there. So there are 3 ways to get 2 tails. So your probability, so the probability of 2 tails is 3 out of 8, because there are 3 ways to get it out of 8 total possibilities. Now, what is the probability of getting at least 2 heads? So this at least makes a difference, because that's including 3 heads as well, in addition to 2 heads. So I'm going to just use the highlighter again, but in a different color. Oops, let me make sure I'm in the highlighter. So I could have 3 heads. That's at least 2. And then I've got at least 2. At least 2. At least 2. So there are 4 choices where you have at least 2 heads. You could have 2 heads or 3 heads. So, oops. Making sure I'm in the right color. So the probability of at least 2 heads is equal to 4 out of 8, which you reduce to 1/2. So you can think of this as, this is the probability of 2 heads plus the probability of 3 heads. Because there was 1 head, so that's 1 out of 8. And 2 heads, there were 3 out of 8. 3 out of 8 plus 1 out of 8, that gives you 4 out of 8. So you can add your probabilities when you're trying to come up with something that says at least or at most. At most would be everything underneath it. So if it said at most 2 heads, that would be 1 head and 2 heads. So you can find probabilities. Basic probability is writing all of your choices, counting how many that occur, and then coming up with your probability from there. Now, it's a little harder to do that when you have more possibilities, like 8 possibilities, that's easy to write down. But say you have 100 possibilities, you don't want to write all those down. And so that's where we start using things like permutations, combinations, that sort of thing that we learned in 9.6. So here's another example. And this one, we have 100 possibilities, but it's broken down for us already. So an independent polling organization interviewed 100 college students to determine their political party affiliations and whether they favor a balanced budget amendment to the Constitution. And so we've got this table where we've got the political parties and then favor, not favor, unsure. Find the probability that a person selected at random for the sample is a person who does not favor the amendment. So we need to figure out how many people do not favor. And so that's where we look at the total for not favor, which is 34. So the probability that someone does not favor the amendment is 34 out of the total number out of 100. And so that is something that we can reduce. 34 divided by 2 is 17 out of 50. So the probability that someone does not favor the amendment would be 17 out of 50. And if you wanted, you can turn this into a decimal, but it's completely fine to leave it as a fraction. Next question. Find the probability that a person selected at random is a Republican. So we look at how many Republicans we have. The total Republicans are 45. So that would be 45 out of 100, which reduces, I can divide those both by 5. That is 9 out of 20. And then we've got the probability that someone selected at random is a Democrat who favors the amendment. So we have to look at the Democrat row and favor. That is 23. So that would be 23 out of 100. And 23 doesn't reduce, so that's the probability. So when you have a table, the probability, when you're given the number of choices already, it's really easy to find probability because it's just basically reading off the table and finding it out of the total. It's very similar to percentages. So now the probability of two events. So two events are mutually exclusive when they have no outcomes in common. What this essentially means is that the outcome of one does not affect the outcome of the other. So tossing a coin, each toss of the coin is mutually exclusive. Or in this case, in another way, it's probability of getting the heads. Probability of two heads is unrelated to the probability of getting three heads. So you can add those together. So if things are mutually exclusive, and I should talk about the language here. So probability of A union, so that U, that is the union symbol. And that means you're looking at the overlap, basically. So that's a probability A plus the probability of B minus them both happening. So that is the intersection. So if you've got two events happening and you've got, let's say, the probability of being a Democrat and the probability of voting no, but there may be some who are Democrats and vote no, so you're double counting, and so you have to subtract that part out. So that's what that equation is saying. But if they're unrelated, if they don't have anything in common, then you can simply add them, because what the intersection, what they have in common would be zero, so you would just subtract that out. So same example, same numbers. So find the probability that a person selected at random is a Democrat or, I should say someone, not something, someone who favors the bill. So there could be overlap here because someone could be a Democrat and favor the bill. So first we have the probability of a Democrat plus the probability of someone favoring, which I'll just use F, minus the probability that you are a Democrat and you favor the bill, because there could be some overlap there. So, probability of being a Democrat, I look at the total, that's 55. And then probability of someone favoring the bill, there's also 55. And then we need to subtract the Democrats who favor the bill because we've double counted them. So that's 23 out of 100. So I'm just grabbing my calculator there. 55 minus 23. That comes out to 87. So the probability that someone is a Democrat or someone who favors the bill could be one over the other. And we could, we do have overlap, so we do have to make sure we don't double count that, would be 87 out of 100. So it's the same thought for a Republican who is either a Republican or someone who is unsure. We could be double counting, so we have to subtract out the overlap. So the probability of being a Republican plus the probability of being unsure, which I'll just say is U, minus the overlap between Republican and unsure. So probability of Republican, that's Republican who favors, 45 out of 100. Probability of unsure is 11 out of 100. And then Republican and unsure is 4. So 45 plus 11 minus 4, we get 52 out of 100, which does reduce to 13 over 25. So are there any questions? I know I didn't stop for questions on the previous ones. Those were more straightforward, but this one is usually a little trickier for people. So are there any questions at this point? Okay. I do want to point out that word or is very important, because if it said the probability of someone was a Republican and unsure, then that would be 4 out of 100. But if it says Republican or unsure, it could be one or the other, and then you subtract the overlap. So there's a big difference between or and here. So you have to really pay attention to that. Two events are independent when the occurrence of one has no effect on the occurrence of the other. So I know earlier I had talked about the coins. I misused. I said they were mutually exclusive. They're independent because the toss of one coin does not affect the toss of the coin the second time. So those are independent events, and things can be independent and not mutually exclusive. So they could be both independent and mutually exclusive or not. So those are not the same thing. If things are independent, then you can multiply the probabilities together. So that's what we did with the coin. As you can, we can see, we multiplied the possibilities together. You can do the same thing if you're trying to find the probability of, say, two tails. You can multiply your probability of getting that. But you do have to take into account that there are different orders, and so that's where we get two combinations. So here's an example where we are doing and, basically. The and is where you're sort of multiplying these things together in a way. So same example, same numbers. Find the probability that a person selected at random from the sample is, I think I accidentally erased what the question was there because it's missing and then it has a question. So I must have accidentally erased too much. What did I intend to have there? Hold on. I have my notes somewhere else. Let me open up and see what I meant. Where is it? Democrat Oh, it was just supposed to be Democrat and favoring the bill. That's all. That's what it was. Okay. I'm like, where? What did I mean to put there? Because I haven't written anything. Okay. So let's see. Dem and favor. So I'll just put that in there. Okay. So the probability that somebody is a Democrat and they favor the bill. So that's where we have to look at the table. That is 23 out of 100. If they're independent, that would be the same as the probability of a Democrat times the probability of favoring the bill, if they are independent events and they are unrelated. If there's a relationship between being a Democrat and favoring the bill, then these would not be independent. So you can test whether there's a relationship between two things by checking to see if they're independent. So the probability of being a Democrat in total, that's 55 out of 100. Oops. I should just write 55 over 100. And now there it goes. It doesn't want to fully erase. 55, there it goes, over 100 times. And the probability of favoring the bill is also 55 out of 100. So I'm going to just convert these to decimal because it's a lot easier when you're looking at these things. So if I have 55 over 100 times 55 over 100, I convert those to decimal. I get 0.3025. So those don't match, so they are not independent. And so that will tell you that whether somebody favors a balanced budget is related to whether what their political party is, because they're not independent events. So there is some relationship here. On, for example, Democrats on what they vote on, because they're not independent events. Your political party can affect what your decision is, and vice versa. So that's what it means when they're not independent, is those probabilities don't come out the same. Are there any questions? Okay, so now this is an example that is basically almost exactly like the one that is on the homework, just different numbers, different combination of things. So I know no this is basically number four on the assignment. Lots of people get stuck on this one. And here we need to use the possibility that you're multiplying things together because they're independent events. Whether you choose a red card doesn't change. Whether you're going to choose a yellow card, those are not fully, choosing a red card doesn't say you have to choose a yellow card, that sort of thing. And we're going to be using combinations here because there's a lot of possibilities. If you have 30 cards, that there are way more possibilities for a five-card hand than we could write. So the deck for a card game contains 30 cards. 10 are red. Or 10 yellow, 5 blue, 1 green, and 4 wild cards. So each player is randomly dealt a 5-card hand. So what is the probability that a hand will contain exactly 3 wild cards? So first we need to find out how many possible hands that you can have. So I'm going to just do this up here. Total hand combinations. Oops. So we're going to use a combination because the order here doesn't matter. You have the same hand regardless of what the order is. So we're not going to do a permutation, it's a combination. So there are 30 cards and we choose 5. So 30 choose 5 will tell us how many possibilities that we have. So if you do that in your calculator, you get 1, 4, 2, 5, 0, 6. 142,506. So that's why we're not writing down all of our choices. Because that is, there are way too many there. Okay, so now we need to find out the probability that a hand will contain exactly three wild cards. And so now we need to figure out how many possible hands are there that have three wild cards? And how do we do this? Well, we split it up into the three wild cards, and then there are two cards left over. And so we're going to use a combination for each of these. So there are four wild cards, and if we need three of them, we're going to use a combination, four, choose, three. And we're going to multiply these, because like I said, these are independent. What I have for a wild card, it's not going to change my probability or, you know, the choices that I could have in the two cards that are not wild. So these are multiplied together. And so now I have two other cards. Now, we need to remove the wild cards because those two other cards are not going to be wild. So there are 30 cards and four are wild. So then we have 26 that are not wild. So out of 26 cards, we're choosing two. And so we're multiplying those to get the number of possibilities here. So four choose three comes to four. 26 choose two, we got 325. And then 4 times 325 is 1,300. So there are 1,300 possible ways to get exactly three wild cards. So now we want to find the probability. And I'm going to just call that the probability of three wild. That is 1,300 over 142,506. And I'm going to just give this as a decimal. So that is the probability that your hand will have exactly three wild cards. Now, what is the probability that a hand will contain three wild cards, one green card, and one blue card? So we've got three wilds, one green, one blue. So we already know how many choices there are for four wild cards. That was four. We found that already in the previous problem. Green cards. So there are one green card. So that would just be one choose one for the number of green cards, which is just one basically, because there's only one way that you can have a green card. So that's going to be four times one. And how many blue cards? There are five blue cards. We want one of them. So that's going to be five, choose one. And so that gives you, there are five different possibilities there. Those you can kind of even do in your head thinking I've got five cards and I'm taking one of them. There's only one way. There's five different choices there of picking one card. So four times one times five is 20. So there are 20 ways that you can get three wild cards, one green card, and one blue card. So now we need the probability of three wild, one green, one blue. And so that's 20 over 142,506. 20 divided by 142,506. And this is 0.00014. So it's because there's much smaller, much fewer possibilities, it's a tiny probability of getting those. So here I'm using the fact that these are independent events. The choices for choosing wild don't affect your choices for choosing different types of cards. And so I can use that fact to figure out the probability without writing all of the possible choices. Are there any questions on this example? Okay, so the last thing is just complements. This is fairly straightforward. The complement of an event A is the collection of all outcomes in the sample space that are not in A. So it's just 1 minus your probability. So if I know that the probability here of, if we go back to the probability of being a Democrat is 23 out of 100, the probability of not being a Democrat is 1 minus 23 over 100, or probability of Democrat 23 would be 55 out of 100, actually. I looked at the wrong number. I looked at my circle number. But if the probability of being a Democrat is 55 out of 100, then 1 minus that probability, that'd be 45 out of 100. So it's the complement is just 1 minus that, and the two need to add up to 100%, essentially. So sometimes it's easier to find the complement and then work with that number rather than finding the actual probability, because it depends on what information you have. Sometimes it's easier to find the complement. So that is it. That should give you everything that you need to know to do pretty much everything on the application assignment. I do, for problem one, just be careful because you're choosing numbers from 0 to 35, so there are 36 numbers because you have to include 0. Let's see, 2 and 3 are straightforward. I did an example of 4. 5, again, these are independent, so you want to use the fact that they're independent where you're multiplying probabilities for number 5. So you should have everything you need to complete the application assignment now. So if you have any questions, you can email me, you can call me, you can send me a hangout, and that's it. So before I end this recording, are there any questions? Probability is really difficult. So, I mean, I have to think about it, and sometimes it's like, wait a minute, am I thinking about this the right way? Because it is very difficult. It doesn't look like you have any questions. So if you do think of any, of course, you're welcome to let me know. All right. Thank you for joining me. And hopefully you'll be at my next one, which will be, let's see, Thursday. Nope, that's next week. This week, Thursday. We're starting to do trig stuff. So I'm going to do a session on right triangles and the unit circle. Trig stuff's usually difficult for people. So I've got several. I've got one on Friday as well. So hopefully I will see you Thursday night. All right. Have a great day. Bye.